Welcome back. So I'm really excited today to tell you about the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem, which is one of the most important results in all of information theory. You're going to see it everywhere now that I'm going to tell you about it. And it's really important, especially when we think about signal processing, control systems, especially compressed sensing and sparsity and kind of the recent trends in applied mathematics. So I'm going to jump in and I'm going to tell you all about this Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem, which basically tells you if you have some signal you're measuring, let's say it's some signal that's oscillating and doing something, how fast you have to measure it to perfectly represent and reconstruct that signal. Okay, and there's really interesting connections to code breaking and other kinds of information theory. So I find this a really fascinating topic, and I hope you do too. So there are two seminal papers by Claude Shannon and Harry Nyquist. Nyquist was a little bit earlier in 1928, Shannon in 1949. Both of them worked at Bell Labs. So Shannon was an American mathematician. Nyquist is a Swedish-American mathematician. And both of them developed a lot of their best work working at Bell Labs, okay, which is kind of this famous think tank where a lot of great ideas came out of. Shannon, in particular, did a lot of wartime research during World War II in encryption and code breaking, and just kind of, you can kind of think of him as America's counterpart of Alan Turing. And in fact, they were contemporaries, and Claude Shannon loved Turing's work because it complemented his so well. So I think that's really interesting as well. Okay, good. So they wrote these two classic papers, Communication in the Presence of Noise and Certain Topics in Telegraph Transmission Theory. And there was this idea of kind of how much can you compress information if you want to send it over a long distance and then be able to decompress it and get the full high resolution signal kind of out at the end. Okay, so a really important problem of their time based on communication and signal processing over long distances. How much can you compress information and expect to get a faithful decompression kind of downstream on the other end? And of course, we already had lots of knowledge about this. There was already Morse code and some kind of redundancy built into communications in telegraphing, but this really put this on a firm mathematical footing. Claude Shannon in particular is many times, oftentimes called the father or the father of kind of information theory. And a lot of what we have in information theory came from Claude Shannon. So he also took ideas from thermodynamics, entropy, and introduced that into information theory. So he introduced, you know, information entropy when you're sending signals over the ocean, okay, across the Atlantic. Nyquist was really pivotal in control theory. So a lot of our classical control theory comes from Nyquist, and a lot of things are named after Nyquist. So these are two titans that kind of came together in this idea of sampling for the sampling theorem. Okay, good. And I'll just also point out that Shannon, you know, also was very deeply interested in kind of this theory of secrecy. And the way he said it is that kind of communication and cryptography are inseparable. You can't study one without inherently analyzing the other. You can't talk about communication theory without the theory of kind of encoding and coding and cryptography. Okay, so that's a really interesting perspective as well. And so I want to kind of just walk you through what they say the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem is, and then how we can interpret it today kind of practically. So in words, the sampling theorem says that a function containing no frequency higher than omega, measured in hertz, is completely determined by sampling that function at 2 omega, again, measured in hertz. So if you have a function, and I'm actually going to say this another way, I want to flip it also. If you have a function and you want to perfectly represent that function, you want to perfectly resolve all of its frequency content perfectly, then you have to sample that function at twice its highest frequency. Okay, so I'll say this a couple ways. And we're used to thinking about functions like an audio signal. You can take its Fourier transform, and it's got a power spectrum that tells you where in that signal, kind of what frequencies are active in that signal. And if you want to perfectly reconstruct that signal in Fourier, remember we can compress that signal and send that information and decompress it. If you want to perfectly represent that information, and you have a highest frequency you care about, you have to sample at twice that highest frequency. Okay? And so that establishes what's known now as the Nyquist rate, which is 2 omega measured in hertz. Or alternatively, it says if you care about a frequency omega, if that's the highest frequency you care about, you have to sample at least as fast as a delta t of 1 over 2 omega in seconds. Okay? And actually, this is really interesting. This is why, if you've ever noticed that your audio sampling, like your MP3, is encoded at 44 kilohertz, that's because humans can hear up to about 20 kilohertz. So you take that highest frequency humans would ever care about, which is about 22 kilohertz, and you have to double that to get perfect fidelity reconstruction when you decompress. Okay, so that's why audio signals are at 44 kilohertz. Okay, good. So I'm gonna just walk you through kind of pictorially how this sampling works, and then we'll talk a little bit more about kind of applications and where you see this every day. Okay, so the idea is that you might have some signal, and this is a little hard to draw. I'm gonna do my best. But let's say you have some signal that has a high frequency in it. Okay, and you by kind of common sense, if you wanted to resolve this this frequency, you might say that you need to pick, you know, at least two measurements per period, right? To get kind of the high and the low. Maybe I'll just draw, you know, to get the highs and the lows of this signal. Maybe let me make sure that this. Ah, that's much better. Okay, so you have this signal, and to get the highs and the lows of the signal, you would need to measure at least 2 points per period. That's kind of common sense, okay? But I'm going to do the thought experiment. What if you downsampled? What if you didn't measure fast enough, okay? If you didn't measure fast enough, so let's say I measure, you know, less frequently than I need to. So I measure maybe now, and then now, and now, I'm not doing a great job here, but you would essentially get a signal that could equally well be described by a lower frequency sine wave. So if you don't sample at this Shannon Nyquist sampling rate, this two times the highest frequency that you care about, then you're potentially going to miss information. And it could get even worse than that. Imagine I measure at exactly the frequency of the highest frequency. So instead of at measuring 2 omega, I measure at omega. So I measure just the peak and the peak and the peak. Then I have no information in this signal. As far as I'm concerned, the signal might as well be that straight line. Okay? And so you can see that there's all of this information that's lost if I don't measure at least the Nyquist sampling frequency of 2 omega. So that 2 omega is critical, because otherwise you'll get this this phenomenon. This is called aliasing, and I'm going to write that up here. So you'll get this aliasing phenomenon, which basically says that as far as your sampling is concerned, these curves are aliases of one another. They might as well be the same person or the same thing as far as this blue sampling is concerned. So if you sample below the Nyquist rate, you're going to get aliasing, and you're going to lose the high frequency components that you might care about. Now, there's a really cool plot that you can make that kind of shows this idea of aliasing. And sometimes this is called frequency folding. So if you look at the power spectral density versus frequency, and remember, omega is the frequency I care about. That's where all of my frequency content. I'm gonna say this a little differently. Let's say here omega is what I'm actually sampling at. So I sample at omega. This is kind of all that I'm able to sample. But let's say that my signal has frequency content up here at 1.5 omega. Okay, so if my signal has frequency content at 1.5 omega, but I sample at omega, I'm actually going to, what I measure to my measurement at this frequency is going to look like this. So it's going to look like an aliased version that's folded over in the frequency domain. I'm going to say this again because this is a little tricky and a little subtle. Okay, so if I'm measuring at omega, at a frequency omega, now based on the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem, that says I could only resolve frequencies that are at half of that sampling rate, because I need to sample twice the highest frequency in my signal. So if I sample at omega, I can only resolve signals that are half of that rate. But if my actual true data, so this is my true data over here, had a frequency that was higher than omega, based on this aliasing, what's going to happen is it's going to look like I measured a system that was half of that frequency, or 0.5 omega. This is going to be kind of the aliased measurement. So from my measurements at frequency omega, I couldn't tell the difference between these two signals. And when I Fourier transform, I'm going to get this erroneous low frequency behavior. So that's exactly what I drew here. This high frequency signal was kind of this signal here, but because I didn't measure it fast enough at the Nyquist rate, because I measured it too slowly, I'm getting this blue erroneous frequency that looks like it's at a lower frequency than it actually is. Okay, so that's this idea of aliasing. You'll see it everywhere in signal processing. Actually, if I wore a shirt with like a checker pattern, you might get like a really fine, like a dress shirt with a really fine mesh pattern, then this camera might actually cause there to be aliasing. So as I walk around from pixel to pixel, you'd almost see it like sparkling. That's a weird camera effect that you get sometimes. And it's because of this idea of aliasing. So you also see this, this is a picture of a curtain. I believe this is at Heathrow Airport, I think. And you can see these kind of moire patterns that you see sometimes in optics. So this is kind of an artistic rendition of these aliasing patterns that you get. We also saw this when we looked at the discrete Fourier transform matrix. So this is literally a visualization of the 1024 by 1024 DFT matrix. But when I downsampled it, when I just shrunk that image on my computer screen because I used less than 1024 by 1024 pixels, you actually see some really interesting aliasing features here. I don't know if you can see it. I hope you can. It looks like there are almost four periodic rolls in X and three periodic rolls in Y. That's not in the high resolution DFT. This is purely because of aliasing, because I'm taking this information and I'm not measuring it finely enough. So that's another application kind of aliasing. Okay? So that's really what I wanted to tell you about, is kind of this really interesting idea of aliasing and the Shannon Nyquist sampling rate. It tells you how fast you have to measure a signal to get faithful reconstruction of the frequency content of that signal. And so I'm just going to, I should probably write it out to be completely clear. So if you want omega, you need to sample at 2 omega. It's really simple, really easy to remember. Now, what's interesting about this, and I'm going to kind of close the lecture on where we're at now. Now, fast forward, you know, 70, 80, 90 years past Shannon and Nyquist to today, advances in applied math and optimization and statistics are starting to change how we think about the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem. So technically speaking, all of the results from Shannon and Nyquist are for broadband signals. So that means signals that are full, jam-packed with frequency content from low frequencies all the way up to that highest frequency that you care about. Broadband, dense signals that you've already kind of compressed down. So think about signals you've zipped up. That is definitely, then the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem absolutely applies to those dense broadband signals. You can't beat the Nyquist sampling theorem and have full, perfect signal reconstruction. But if your signal is not broadband or dense, if it is only a couple of frequencies that are high frequencies, you technically can, in fact, sometimes under some conditions, beat the Nyquist sampling frequency on average. And I'm going to talk about this more in the context of compressed sensing and reconstructing audio signals. But for now, I'm just going to walk you through at a very high level what we expect to see. So here we have a signal F, which is the sum of two sine waves at 73 hertz and 531 hertz. And so what the Shannon Nyquist sampling theorem would say is that to fully resolve this F, I would have to sample twice the highest frequency, or twice 531, which is 1,062 samples per second. That's how fast I'd have to sample to perfectly reconstruct this signal. Okay, and here's the power spectrum, here's the signal. Now, that is technically only true for broadband signals, but this is not a broadband signal. This signal is very sparse in the frequency domain. There's only two frequency peaks, only two tones making up this function. And so you can get away, I'm going to zoom in here. If I measured uniformly below the Shannon-Nyquist sampling theorem, or Shannon Nyquist limit, if I uniformly sampled below the Nyquist sampling rate, I would get a terrible signal reconstruction and I would get this aliasing. But if I measure randomly, but on average at 128 samples per second, so well below the Shannon Nyquist sampling rate, but if I do it randomly, not regularly or uniformly, then results in compressed sensing say that you can actually faithfully reconstruct the sparse vector in the Fourier domain, the sparse power spectrum, and then you can inverse Fourier transform and reconstruct your full signal essentially with no aliasing. So this is a really cool result in the field of compressed sensing. I don't know why this is comped. This is spelled wrong. It should be compressed sensing or compressive sampling. And the basic idea is that if I sample randomly in time, I can get away with a much lower average sampling rate than predicted by Shannon Nyquist if my signal is sparse. So I'm going to tell you a lot more about this. You're going to learn about this in kind of this lecture series on compressed sensing. So there's going to be more about this for you to dig into. But the basic idea, just to recap, is that if you have a signal F and you care about frequencies up to frequency omega, then you have to sample at 2 omega, or else you're going to get aliasing and you're going to get this frequency folding phenomenon. All right, thank you.